I'm Renato Lopez, professor of medicine at Duke University, and I'm here today with Alex Fornero, one of our chief fellows at DCRI, to be discussing with today a paper that we just published in European Heart Journal about real-world data. So, Alex, this paper, as you know, it has been a very important aspect, which is to put this in perspective in terms of the whole landscape of clinical research. When we first started with this idea, of trying to define what real-world data or real-world evidence means was to use a maybe classic and true example, maybe a research field that we could use as an example that we had randomized trials and different types of studies and real-world data. And we can maybe try to define what real-world data means. And because of the confusion that people are now using these terms in different ways, so real-world data really means different things for different people, I think one of our key goals was to try to standardize the definition using a real example, and we chose atrial fibrillation and stroke prevention, and try to point out what is the strength, what are the limitations, and what are the things that researchers, regulatory authorities, and even scientific communities need to be aware of. So give me your thoughts. Did we choose right the AFib and stroke prevention as a good example?
Yeah, I think atrial fibrillation and stroke prevention is a good example because, as you said, there are a lot of examples of traditional randomized clinical trials as well as observational studies. And I think that that kind of helps frame what we mean by real-world data. And I think where we started was to say, well, what does real-world data mean? You know, what does that describe? And then. Even further than that, what do people that are reading a study or looking at research want to know?
Correct.
And we kind of came to two important questions. And the first is, who are the patients that are enrolled in the study? Because that has implications for who you can apply the results to. And the second question is, can I use this study to determine whether a treatment causes an effect?
Correct.
And so that kind of led to thinking about real-world data and study design on two separate dimensions.
Correct.
So the first question that you want to ask is, where does this data come from? And that's kind of where we fit real-world data into it. So data that comes from clinical care or from administrative claims, data that's generated outside of the research setting, that's real-world data.
Correct.
And data that is generated for research purposes exclusively, so registries, clinical trials, that's what we call non-real-world data, even though you know, it's still generated in the real world.
Correct.
And then on a totally separate axis is, how was the study designed? Did investigators just observe the way that patients were treated in routine clinical care, and that we call that observational data, or was treatment assigned? And that's
Correct.
An interventional study. And that's a really important question because only when treatment is assigned and patients are randomized to one treatment or another, can you really make claims that the treatment causes
Correct.
Whatever effects you see?
Correct. And as you know, we did this paper with the help with Rob Califf, John Alexander, Greg Lieb, and Jan Stefan. And we thought a lot about that. And I think you summarized right. The two key points to define real-world data is how the collection of the data was done, for research purpose or non-research purpose. So I think that's kind of the first really differentiation. And then the second one, as you mentioned, was there an assignable intervention? And I think if we are able to think with these two dimensions, you're going to be able to classify most of your type of studies and study designs. And in this regard, Alex, we created a very nice figure in terms of type of studies and what answers those types of studies can, what questions those type of studies actually can answer. Summarize for us, why did we do that?
So if you want to know how a medication is being used in routine clinical practice, that's the type of study that you want observational data, because if the treatment is assigned, you don't know how the medication is used in practice. And you want data that's as close to real-world data as possible, because you don't want to know how it's being used in the context of a clinical trial or a specialized group of centers in a registry. You want to know how it's being used in the real world.
Correct.
Similarly, if you want to know what dose of a medication is being used, in that sense, you don't, again, want specialized data. You don't want the treatment to have been assigned. You want real-world data, and you want observational studies. But if you want to know whether apixaban is better than warfarin for stroke prevention and atrial fibrillation, or whether apixaban is better than dabigatran, or apixaban is better than rivaroxaban, or any of those combinations, what you really need is an assigned intervention. You need randomization to really know the difference. And you know, when thinking about whether you want to use real-world data or non-real-world data for those studies, what we have are studies that use non-real-world data. An advantage of that, of using non-real-world data, is that the data is very high quality. You know what you're looking at. When you get into non-real-world data, it's not as high quality necessarily, but it is closer to the types of patients that you see in routine clinical practice because the selection, you're not selecting a group of patients out of the patient population, you're getting all the patients.
Correct.
So, you know, when you want to know how a medication, when you want to compare medications, you need an assignable intervention. But depending on the study that you want to do, real world data or non real world data could be the most appropriate source.
Correct. And I think one important point that we made in our paper is that there is no one type of data is being better than the other. I think it depends on the question.
Right.
Whatever is the question, you're going to have to find the best data to answer that question. And one caution that we raise in this paper is that we should be cautioned about concluding things from data sets that does not allow us to do so.
Right.
I think that's the key, really, to identify the question and then choose the right design to be able to state the conclusion that you want to state. And in this sense, it seems that the ideal world would be to have the broad population that the real world has, because there is no inclusion-exclusion criteria. Everybody gets in, or very minimal. But insert randomization. Insert the ability to randomize to two strategies, or two treatment, or two devices. Is that possible? I mean, we talked about hybrid approach. We learned from the Swedish group about the registry randomization being embedded in registries. So how are we doing now in terms of being able to randomize within real-world data?
I think that it's possible. I think that there are a few studies that are doing it. Adaptable is one such study where they're comparing different doses of aspirins and taking the data from electronic health records. The Artemis trial that the DCRI recently completed was a cluster randomized trial conducted in a real-world setting with broad inclusion criteria. So it's certainly possible, and it's really important that we do this kind of research. Okay. Because it really gives us, for certain types of questions, you know, comparing two medications that are already approved or comparing health services interventions, being able to embed randomization into the real world really does give us the best of both worlds and helps us answer some really important questions that patients and physicians really want the answers to.